Continue our discussion about the infinite series which we started in the last class. Let us recall that infinite series is an expression of the following form. Okay, sigma xn, n going from either 1 or 0 or some such number. Okay, and we have seen that along with every such infinite series, we associate a sequence Sn which we call a sequence of partial sum. It is sum of the first n elements in that sequence. Okay. And depending on whatever happens to Sn, we say that if Sn converges, we say that the series converges or summable, and whatever is the limit of Sn, we say that is the sum of the series. And similarly, if Sn diverges, we say that the series diverges. Okay. And so we can easily see the, okay, let us see one or two standard examples of this before proceeding. So let us, now this is, as you know, it is called geometric series, sigma x to the power n, and it is customary to start this for n going from 0 to infinity. Okay. So in this case, if you look at Sn, Sn will be 1 plus x plus etcetera etcetera up to x to the power n. Okay, x to the power n, and so this is nothing but, since this is a geometric progression, so you can sum this as 1 minus x to the power n plus 1 divided by 1 minus x. Okay, and so whether the series converges or not depends on whether the limit of this exists as n goes to infinity. Okay. And out of, you can see only term which depends on n here is this x to the power n plus 1, all the term, other terms are independent of n. And here we have seen that this converges to 0 if mod x is less than 1. Okay, we have seen that this converges to 0 if mod x is less than 1. Okay, so it means that this series converges to 1 by 1 minus x if mod x is less than 1. Okay. So we can say that the sum of this series is 1 by 1 minus x if mod x is less than 1, if mod x is less than 1. Okay. If mod x is bigger than or equal to 1, this will not, this limit will not exist, limit of this will not exist, and this series diverges. That is also fairly easy to see. Okay. All right. Let us see one more example. Suppose you take sigma, okay, 1 by n into n plus 1, n going from 1 to infinity. Okay. Now here only worthwhile thing to notice is the following, that 1 by n into n plus 1 is nothing but 1 by n minus 1 by n plus 1. Okay. And hence if I look at this partial sum Sn, Sn will be, okay, let us write Sn as x1 plus extra xn. Okay, and so that is x1 is 1 minus half, that is 1 by n minus 1 by n plus 1. So x2 is 1 by 2 minus 1 by 3, etcetera, etcetera. So finally, xn is 1 by n minus 1 by n plus 1. Okay, and it is clear that the middle terms will cancel, and the final sum will be nothing but 1 minus 1 by n plus 1. Okay, all right. And this tends to 1 as n tends to infinity. So the sum of, so this series converges and its sum is 1. Okay. So in general, this is how you decide whether a series converges or not. Okay. Look at the partial sum, okay, and take the limit of the partial sum as n goes to infinity. All right. Next, what we want to see is that apply the various theorems that we have known about the sequences to get the corresponding results about the series. Okay. Let us look at that last thing that we saw about the sequences first. Okay. We have seen that sequence of real numbers converges if and only if it is Cauchy. Okay, it's a Cauchy sequence. Okay. So let us just how does it translate in terms of infinite series? Okay, we can say that this, let us write this as a theorem. Okay, sigma xn, n going from 1 to infinity converges, okay, if and only if this SN is a Cauchy sequence, okay, okay, if and only if SN is a Cauchy sequence. Let us write this in the full form, okay. What is meant by Cauchy sequence? That for every epsilon bigger than 0 there exists n0, etc., okay. So that means if and only for every epsilon bigger than n0, sorry, for every epsilon bigger than 0 there exists n0 in n, such that for all n and m bigger than or equal to n0 we must have mod sn minus sm less than epsilon, okay, mod sn minus sm less than epsilon, okay. Only thing is I want to make a slight change in the way of writing this mod sn minus sm, okay, right. N and m both are bigger than or equal to n0, so let us say one of them is bigger than the other, okay. So suppose let us say n is bigger than m, okay. Let us say n is bigger than m and m is bigger than or equal to n0, okay, right. Then sn is x1 plus x2 etc plus xn, okay, and what will be sm? Sm will be x1 plus x2 plus xm, then plus, if since m is smaller, plus xm plus 1 etc etc up to xn, okay. So what is sn minus sm or sm minus what is sn minus sm? It is this part xm plus 1 etc up to xn, okay. So I can say that instead of writing like the instead of this I shall say this is same as sigma xj, j going from m plus 1 to n, okay. So if you take any two numbers m and n bigger than n0, okay, and suppose m is strictly less than n, and if you take all the sums of all these sum of all the terms going from xm plus 1 to xn, then that should be less than epsilon, okay. In other words, given any epsilon for large values of n, sum of that part, whatever large numbers m and n you take the sum from xm plus 1 to xn, okay, its absolute value should be less than epsilon, okay. All right, okay. There is one very important and immediate but simple consequence of this, okay. You can see that there is nothing to prove here, okay. This simply follows by observing that we have just rewritten the same thing, that SN converges if and only if SN is a Cauchy sequence in a different language, okay. Right. All right. One obvious corollary of this is the following, okay. Suppose I take m is equal to n, okay. Suppose I take m is equal to n, okay, then there will be only one term here, okay, and that will be mod xn less than epsilon, okay. So what is the meaning of that? For every epsilon there exists n0 such that whenever n is bigger than or equal to n0, mod xn is less than epsilon. What is the meaning of that? It means xn tends to 0, right? Right. It simply means xn tends to 0, okay. So if the series converges, okay, if sigma xn converges, then xn goes to 0, okay. So if sigma xn converges, and that follows simply by taking n is equal to m here, okay, because that is how you define saying that xn converges to 0, right, okay. So if sigma xn converges, then xn goes to 0. Let us write it like this: limit of xn as n tends to infinity, that is equal to 0. Now there is a very obvious question here, okay, and that is, what about the converse? Okay. Again, it's well known that the converse is false, but we shall, and the only way to say show that something is false, you need to give a counter example, okay. Yeah, so that's something we shall see little later, okay. All right. Okay, so this is sometimes called Cauchy criteria for the convergence of the series, okay. All right. there is one more thing that follows from this, and that is the following. Let us define what is meant by absolute convergence. Absolute convergence. Okay. Okay. Now we say that the series sigma xn converges absolutely. Okay. N going from 1 to infinity converges absolutely. Absolutely, if you take this series of absolute values sigma mod xn, n going from 1 to infinity, sigma mod xn, n going from 1 to infinity, okay, that converges. And so again the obvious question is, what is the relationship between the convergence and absolute convergence? Okay. And then again the well known thing here is that every absolutely convergent series is convergent. Okay. So let us write in that. Okay. Every absolutely convergent series, absolutely convergent series is convergent. Converges. Okay. Proof follows from this Cauchy's criteria. Okay. Proof follows from this Cauchy's criteria. Okay. So what we, okay, let us see how does it that follow. Okay. Okay. Now since we are dealing with two series here, sigma xn and sigma mod xn. Let us give some notations for the partial sums of both. Okay, for this anyway we have already derived by Sn. So let us say Sn as x1 plus etc up to xn, and suppose partial sum of this series I call Tn. Okay. Okay. Tn is let us say mod x1 plus mod x2 etc plus mod xn. Okay. Alright. We want to show that this series converges. Okay. We want to show that this series converges, and using this theorem, it is enough to show that this happens. Okay, right? Okay. So let us just show this. Okay. Let us just show this. Okay. So let us say that let epsilon be bigger than zero. Okay. Let epsilon be bigger than zero. Okay. Then we know that since this series converges. Okay, this series converges, we know that this series satisfies this criteria. Okay. So for that series there exists n0 such that all these things happen. Okay. So there exists n0 since sigma mod xn converges, sigma mod xn converges. Okay, I'll continue here. There exists n0 in n such that for all, let us write it, n bigger than m, bigger than or equal to n0, mod tn minus tm is less than epsilon. Okay. Okay. But what is tn minus tm? Tn is mod x1 plus mod x2 plus mod xn. Okay. So similarly, we can say that Tn minus Tm should be same as sigma mod xj. Okay, sigma mod xj, j going from m plus 1 to n. Okay, so that is this is nothing but that is we can say that sigma mod xj, j going from m plus 1 to n less than epsilon. But now what is the relationship between this term and this term? It is it clear that this is less than or equal to this? Okay, so this implies that sigma xj, j going from m plus 1 to n, absolute value of this, that is less than or equal to this, okay, right, and that is less than epsilon, okay. So this is a very important theorem. Again, let us see what exactly this depends on. Every absolutely convergent series converges, okay. How did we prove this? We proved this using this Cauchy's criteria, okay. How was Cauchy's criteria proved? By using the fact that every Cauchy sequence is convergent, okay. And how was that proved? By using LUB action, right, order completeness of R, okay. So the fact that every absolutely convergent series converges depends in fact on the completeness or order completeness of the real number system, or actually the so called LUB action, right, okay. Now since, okay, again here also the same question, what can we say about the converse, okay, that is it true that whenever a series converges it also converges absolutely? That is false, okay, and again to show that it is false we need to give a counter example, but that also we shall discuss little later, okay, that is when we come across some more methods of checking convergence and divergence, okay. Now but there is one very good thing here, is that this gives us a class of convergent series, okay. Let us, whatever the series is given, what you can do first is to check whether it is absolutely convergent, okay. And to check absolutely convergent you just need to look at sigma mod xn, and the terms of this series are always non-negative, okay. So if we devise some methods of checking the convergence or divergence of the series of non-negative terms, okay, that will be good for checking absolute convergence. And since we know that every absolutely convergent series converges, such series will converge, okay. So let us first confine our attention for some time to what are called series of non-negative terms. Obviously what does this mean? That we will say that this series sigma xn n going from 1 to infinity is the series of non-negative term. This simply means that each of xn is bigger than or equal to 0, xn is bigger than or equal to 0 for all n, okay. Right. Of course sometimes these are also called series of positive terms, okay, which would mean that each xn is bigger than 0, but you can see that that is a minor difference, okay. If some of the xn's are 0, you can simply remove them from the series, it will not make any difference to the series or to the sum of the series. All right, now what is the major advantage of this series or over the other series? It is again, if you look at the sequence of partial sums, let us again look at the sequence of partial sums sn. Remember sn is sigma xj, j going from 1 to n, okay, and sn plus 1 is this plus xn, right, sn plus 1 is sn plus xn plus 1, okay, right. And we know that each xn is bigger than or equal to 0, so what does it say about the sequence sn? It is a monotonically increasing sequence, okay. Sequence sn, if the series is of non-negative term, then the sequence of partial sums is a monotonically increasing sequence. So we know this, that sn is a monotonically increasing sequence, okay. And in case of monotonically increasing sequences, we know that that converges if and only if it is bounded above, okay. A monotonically increasing sequence converges if and only if it is bounded above, okay. So that immediately gives us one method of checking convergence of this series, okay. What is that? The series of positive term, non-negative terms converges if and only if its sequence of partial sums is bounded above, okay. Its sequence of partial sums is bounded above, okay. So we can just write that as a theorem. The series of non-negative terms. Converges if and only if its sequence of partial sums is bounded above. Partial sums is bounded above. So this gives a method of checking whether a series of non-negative terms is convergent or not. All that you need to do is look at the sequence of partial sums and simply show that it is bounded above, okay, right. If you show that, that's enough. It's enough to show that a series is convergent. Similarly, if you show that it is unbounded, okay, then you can immediately conclude that it is divergent, okay. Now there is one more thing, the sequence is monotonically increasing, okay. So even if you are able to show this for some subsequence, it is enough. Is it clear? Okay. Suppose instead of showing that Sn is bounded above, I simply show that the sequence S1, S3, S5, S7 that is bounded above, okay. Will that be sufficient? Because S4 is less than S5, okay. S6 is less than or equal to. So even if S1, S3, S5 that is bounded, that is enough, okay. Similarly, if that is unbounded, again that is enough, okay. So since when the sequence is monotonic, okay, to show that it is bounded above, it is just sufficient to show that any subsequence is bounded above, okay. And of course, to show that it is unbounded, that is always there, okay, even if you show that because if the sequence is bounded, all its subsequences also must be bounded, right. That is true for any sequences, whether monotonic or not, okay. So to show that a sequence is unbounded, it is enough to show that some subsequence is unbounded. But in case of monotonically increasing sequences, to show that sequence is bounded above, for that also it is sufficient to show that some subsequence is bounded above, right, okay. Now this particular thing, that is this observation, leads to again very important observation, the so called comparison test. I mean, the idea of the comparison test is basically just this, that see, suppose you are taking two, basically here we want to check that the sequence Sn, once there are two series and if the terms of both are non-negative, okay, then suppose, let us say there are two series Xn and Yn, and suppose for each n Xn is less than or equal to Yn, okay, Xn is less than or equal to Yn, okay. Then suppose you denote the corresponding partial sums by Sn and Tn, then obviously Sn is less than or equal to Tn, okay. So let us just write this, okay. Suppose there are two series sigma Xn, n going from 1 to infinity, and sigma Yn, n going from 1 to infinity. And suppose this happens, suppose 0 less than or equal to Xn less than or equal to Yn, okay. Now, so what the comparison test says is that if sigma Yn converges, that sigma Xn also converges. And what is the proof? Proof is what I said just now, okay. So suppose you take Sn as the sequence of partial sums of this Xn. So let us say Sn is sigma Xj, j going from 1 to n, and Tn as sigma Yj, j going from 1 to n, okay. we know that xn is less than or equal to yn for each n. That is, in other words, xj is less than or equal to yj for each j. Okay. So what does it say about sn and tn? Okay. So it means sn is less than or equal to tn. Okay. Sn is less than or equal to tn. Remember, both are periodically increasing sequences. Okay. Okay. So all that we need to, once we have a series of non-negative terms, all that we need to check is that the sequence of partial sums is bounded above. Okay. Now, if sigma yn converges, it means tn is bounded above. Okay. If sigma yn converges, it means tn is bounded above. Okay. Does it say immediately that sn also must be bounded above? That's it. Okay. Okay. And well, sometimes this whole thing is also said in a slight. I mean, okay. Let us write that. That is because it is fairly common. Okay. If sigma xn diverges, then sigma yn also diverges. Can you see that this is basically the same thing written in a different language, right? Because if this were false, what must happen? That sigma yn converges and sigma xn converges and sigma yn diverges. So that is not possible. Okay. If the sometimes this series, when this happens, we say that the series yn dominates the series xn. Okay. And if the series which dominates converges, then the series which is dominated also converges. Okay. All right. And if the series which is dominated diverges, this series also diverges. Okay. Right after defining the convergence and divergence of a series, I have said that if you remember that convergence or divergence of a series does not depend on what happens to a finite number of terms. Okay, right. So if a finite number of terms are added or removed, it doesn't matter for the convergence or divergence. Now, using that, what we can say here is that, see, generally we say that this happens for all n. Okay, right. But even if this happens for all n bigger than or equal to some n zero, still it is okay, right? Because what happens to the first finite number of terms doesn't matter. Okay. So in comparison test, okay, that is in general we use this condition 0 less than or equal to xn less than or equal to yn for all n. But since it does not matter what happens to a finite number of terms, even if this condition is satisfied after some n, okay, let us say n bigger than or equal to 100, okay, still the same conclusion will be valid. Okay, right. Okay. Now this is a very useful test to check given the series of positive terms converges or diverges. But to make effective use of this test, we should have some standard list of series which converge or diverge. Okay. And that list is given by this sigma 1 by n to the power p, n going from 1 to infinity. Okay. And p is bigger than 0. Okay, p is bigger than 0. Okay. Okay. And again, this it's a well known result that this will converge if p is bigger than 1 and this diverges if p is, okay. So this converges if p is strictly bigger than 1 and diverges if 0 less than p less than or equal to 1. Okay. All right. Okay. So once we have this list of series of given a series of positive terms, if it is possible to compare that series with one of these series, okay, then we can conclude about the convergence or divergence of any of those series. Okay. All right. Let us first look at the proof of this. By the way, given a series of or any series, not only series of positive terms, any series, In general, there can be several ways of showing that the series converges or diverges, okay, not a unique method, okay. Okay. For example, we have seen that this series sigma 1 by n into n plus 1, we have seen that this series converges, okay. Now I can say that we have seen that by different method, okay, but this is also a series of non-negative terms, okay, right. So we can also compare this with the series sigma 1 by n square, okay. Can you see that one, this each of this term is less than or equal to each of this term here, okay. And by, suppose we prove this, then by this it will mean that this is a convergent series, okay. So that will give this is also a convergent series, okay. Of course this comparison test will not say anything about the sum, okay. Again, that is also not very correct to say. It will say that the sum of this is less than or equal to sum of this, okay. Suppose in this case, suppose sigma by n converges and then sigma xn also converges, the sum of this series will be less than or equal to sum of this series, but beyond that we cannot say anything, okay. Okay. Now let us see how this can be proved. What I will do is that I shall just take one or one sample case of each type, okay, one for the convergence and one for divergence, and the general case I shall leave it to you as an exercise, okay, right. So let me take this case first. Suppose I take the case p equal to 1, that means we are looking at the series sigma 1 by n, n going from 1 to infinity, okay. We, to show that this is divergent, we need to show that its sequence of partial sums is unbounded, okay. And I told you just some time ago that it is sufficient to show that some subsequence is unbounded, okay, right. And the idea is as follows: you look at this partial sums 1 by 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 4 etcetera etcetera, okay, right. Let us say there is some that last point I will write little later, okay. You can say that suppose I take the partial sum s1, that is 1, partial sum s2 is 1 plus half, okay, partial sum s2. Suppose I look at s4, okay, suppose I look at s4, okay, then I will say that s4 is bigger than or equal to 1 plus half plus these two terms, 1 by 3 plus 1 by 4, okay, right. Now each of these terms are, this 1 by 4 is smaller, okay. So I can say that this is bigger than 2 into 1 by 4, okay, this is bigger than 2 into 1 by 4, so which is again 1 by 4. So I can, so S4 is bigger than or equal to 1 plus, let us say 1 plus, for the time being I shall write 2 into 1 by 2, right. S4 is bigger than, okay, all right, okay. Now next I consider, let us say S8, S8, okay, that is I take four, next 4 terms, that is 1 by 5 plus 1 by 6 plus 1 by 7 plus 1 by 8, take this group, okay. In this group the smallest term is 1 by 8, okay, and since I have taken 4 terms, the sum of them must be less than, bigger than or equal to 4 into 1 by 8, okay, sum of them must be bigger than 4 into 1 by 8, so that is again 1 by 2. Okay, so that gets added to this, because so if S4 is already bigger than or equal to 1 plus 2 into 1 by 2, S8 should be bigger than or equal to 1 plus 3 into 1 by 2, okay. So now what is the, can you predict something from here, okay. Similarly, for example, now next, suppose I take now S16, okay. S16, that will be again 1 by 9 plus 1 by up to 1 by 16, the smallest term there will be 1 by 16, there will be 8 such terms, their sum is again 1 by 2, okay. So S16 will be bigger than up to 1 plus 4 into 1 by 2, okay. Okay. So what is the general pattern, okay. Yes,
SN square,
not N square. 8 is not n square, yes, s 2 power n, yes, that is right, s, so s suffix 2 power n is bigger than or equal to 1 plus n into 1 by 2, okay. And does it follow from here that this s 2 power n is unbounded, okay, because it is bigger than 1 plus n by 2 and this number I can make arbitrarily big, okay, this number can be made arbitrarily big, okay. So this implies that this s suffix 2 power n is unbounded, okay, and hence sn also is unbounded and so this series diverges, okay. And the same proof will work if you take instead of n here, if you take n power p for p less than or equal to 1, okay. Small modification of this will work to show that the series diverges for this case 0 less than p less than or equal to 1, okay. Now let us take one from this group, p bigger than 1, okay. Let me take sigma 1 by n square. And again I say whatever we do for p equal to 2 with obvious small modifications will work for any p bigger than 1, okay. That part I shall leave it to you as an exercise, okay. So let us look at now again the idea is basically similar, okay. Just make the groups of the partial sums here, okay. Just make the groups of partial sums, group the terms in the partial sums, and here we have chosen the smallest among them and then use the inequality less than or equal to. Now we want to show that Sn is bounded, so we need to use the inequality less than or equal to, so obviously we should choose the biggest among the terms, okay. That is the idea, okay. So now in this case now Sn is 1 plus 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 3 square plus 1 by 4 square etcetera, okay. Okay, let me begin with S3, okay. S3 is 1 plus, now I will take the group of these two, okay. I will take the group of these two. Now in these two, 1 by 2 square is the bigger term, right. 1 by 2 square is a bigger term, so the sum, so 1 by 3, so the sum of these two must be less than or equal to 2 times 1 by 2 square, right. It must be less than or equal to 2 times, so this will be less than or equal to say 2 times 2 square, okay. Next what I will do is I will take again the next 4 terms, that is 1 by 4 square plus 1 by 5 square plus 1 by 6 square plus 1 by 7 square, okay. So that is S7, no, not equal to, this is less than or equal to. So S7 will be less than or equal to 1 plus, okay, this 2 by 2 square let me write now as 1 by 2. Here the smallest term is 1 by 4 squares and there are 4 such terms, okay. So the sum should be less than or equal to 4 by 4 square, okay, right. So less than 1 by 4, okay, 4 by 4 square, okay. And now you can predict, okay, what is going to happen next. I will take next 8 terms, okay, that is starting from 1 by 8 square and going up to 1 by 15 square. There are 8 terms, each is less than or equal to 1 by 8 square, okay. So the sum should be less than or equal to 1 by 8. And that is S15. So S15 is less than or equal to 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 4 plus 1 by 8. So what follows from here? Again, you can predict what will be general pattern. This number something like here we had got S2 power n. This is not 2 power n, it is 2 power n minus 1. Okay. It is 2 power n minus 1. And that is less than or equal to, you can see it on the right hand side you have a geometric series with this common ratio 1 by 2 and we already showed that that is a convergent series, okay. We already shown that is a convergent series, so these partial sums are bounded, okay. So what it shows is that this s 2 power n minus 1, this is bounded above. See, in general, for an arbitrary sequence, if you show that some subsequence is bounded above, will not imply that the whole sequence is bounded above, okay. But in case of monotonically increasing sequences, that is true, okay, because what we have shown is that this sequence, this subsequence, that is s to the power n minus 1, that is the sequence s1, s3, s7, s15, that sequence is bounded above, okay. But what we know is that if you take, for example, s10 is less than or equal to s15, okay. Or similarly, if you take any n, that n is less than or equal to 2 to the power n minus 1, okay. So sn is less than or equal to s 2 to the power n minus 1, so the whole sequence also is bounded above, okay. All right. And so that shows that this series is convergent, okay. Now, in a similar way, you can take any p bigger than 1, and then this same idea will work. Okay. I shall leave that to you as an exercise. Okay. So that's about the comparison test and how one uses comparison test. Here we have seen an example. Okay. Let us now look at one more test for the checking the convergence of this series of non-negative terms. That is called root test. Very powerful test, this one. Of course, comparison test is also quite powerful. Okay. Suppose this is a series of non-negative terms once again, n going from 1 to infinity, each xn is bigger than or equal to 0. Okay. So you look at nth root of xn. Okay. You look at nth root of xn. Or xn to the power 1 by n, whatever you call it, nth root of xn, okay, and consider the limit superior of that. Okay. Let see xn in general, nth root of xn may or may not be a convergent sequence, okay. If it is bounded, limit superior will always exist. Limit superior will always exist, okay. If limit superior is does not exist as a finite real number, you take that as infinity, okay, right. So let this number be L, okay. Then what does the test say? The test says that if, okay, this is the first thing, if L is less than 1, then sigma xn converges, okay. Second thing is that if L is bigger than 1, then sigma xn diverges. Okay. And if L is equal to 1, the test gives no information, okay. If L is equal to 1, the test, you cannot conclude anything, okay. No conclusion, I will say, no information. No information about the convergence or divergence. As far as this last thing is concerned, what does it mean that if L is equal to 1, it is also possible that the series converges, it is also possible that the series diverges, okay. And you can see that we already have examples of both this kind. If you look at this series sigma 1 by n, okay, in this case what will be nth root of xn, it will be 1 by nth root of n, right. It will be 1 by, and we have already shown that this nth root of n goes to 0, goes to 1 as n goes to infinity. So this tends to 1. Okay. So in this case, L is equal to 1 and the series diverges, right. On the other hand, if you look at this series 1 by n square, okay, right, there it will be 1 by n to the power 2 to the power n, okay, which will also be, its limit also will be 1, okay, and that series converges, okay. So if L is equal to 1, you cannot conclude anything from the root test. Now let us look at this one. remember that when we discuss this limit superior, okay, we have shown that if you take any epsilon, if you take any epsilon, then there exists some n0 such that all elements of the sequence xn lie between, not lie between, are less than that l plus. So suppose I take any epsilon, and then if I look at a number l plus epsilon, then I can find a number n0 such that all the elements of the sequence are less than that l plus epsilon. Okay, right? Okay. Now suppose l is less than 1. Okay, I can always choose an epsilon in such a way that l plus epsilon is also less than 1. Right? I can also, l is a real number. L is less than 1. Can I always choose a positive epsilon such that l plus epsilon is also less than 1? Okay, obvious choice is 1 minus l by 2. That's a positive number. Okay. Anyway, it doesn't matter. You choose some number which is strictly bigger than l and less than 1. Okay. So let's look at the proof. Okay, suppose I call that number eta. Okay, let the proof of this. Okay, let l less than eta less than 1. Okay. Then take the difference between eta and l as epsilon. Okay. Then there should exist some n0 such that for n bigger than or equal to n0, xn is less than l plus epsilon, that is eta. Okay. So I will simply say that there exists n0 in n such that n0 in n such that xn, not xn, it is not limit superior of xn, remember, it is limit superior of nth root of xn. Okay, it is limit superior of nth root of xn. Okay, so let me write xn to the power 1 by n, xn to the power 1 by n, that is less than l, that is less than l, not l, that is less than, okay, it is less than eta, okay, l plus epsilon. Okay. Or which is same as saying that xn is less than eta to the power n. Xn is less than eta to the power n. Okay, right? Now you just use the comparison test. See, you have the series sigma xn, and you take this series sigma eta power n. You take the series sigma eta power n. Okay, and this is where I said that this xn less than this is not happening for all n, it is happening for all n bigger than or equal to n0, but that is okay. Okay, this is something I commented right after discussing the comparison test, that is that if xn less than or equal to yn, even if it happens for some n bigger than or equal to n0, still the conclusions of the comparison test are valid. Okay, now this is a geometric series, and it this eta is less than 1, so this is a convergent series. So by comparison test, this original series should also converge. Okay. By comparison test, the original series should also converge. Okay. See, you may have learnt this root test even in your undergraduate course, but it is highly unlikely that you would have used this limit superior. Okay. Okay. In the undergraduate books, the way in which it is given is that limit of this nth root of xn is equal to l. Okay, but this is more general because that limit may or may not exist, but limit superior will always exist. Okay, limit superior will always exist. Okay, so this you can apply for more general series. Okay, all right. Now let us look at this second part. Okay, that is also very similar. Basically, follows by using the properties of limit superior. Okay. Remember what we have shown is that see, this is a limit superior of this sequence. Okay, right? If you remember, we have shown that there exists a subsequence of this which converges to the limit superior. Okay, there exists a subsequence of this which converges to the limit superior. Okay, so let us suppose I call that subsequence, let us say x n z. Okay, so there exists a subsequence x n z converging to L. Okay, and L is bigger than 1. Okay, L is bigger than 1. Okay, Now let me just tell you a rough argument here. If some sequence converges to something L bigger than 1, is it clear to you that the infinitely many terms of that sequence also must be bigger than 1, right? Okay. Now if that is the case, can that sequence tend to 0? No, not x n z, x n z to the power 1 by n z, okay. So x n, so infinitely many terms of the sequence x n z by 1 to the power 1 by n z, those are bigger than 1, okay. If this is the case, can the sequence x n z tend to 0? Okay, it cannot tend to 0. Then can x n tend to 0? That cannot happen. If a sequence tends to 0, it cannot happen that infinitely many terms of the sequence are bigger than 1, okay. But if the sequence x n does not tend to 0, what do you know about the convergence of the series? That was one of our first theorem, okay, that if the sigma xn converges, then the sequence xn must go to 0, okay. That is not happening here, okay, that is not happening here. So the series sigma xn must be a divergent series, right, okay. And the third case anyway we have already seen. So that is an information about the root test. There is one more test of the similar type which is called ratio test that we shall discuss in the next class. We will stop with this one.